currently, as we stand, just a couple weeks, a couple months away from the election, Ben Hovland, approximately 3/4 of all eligible voters can cast their ballots by mail. We are expecting a big spike in mail-in voting in November. How is that going to play out, and how large of an increase are officials expecting?
Yeah, thanks, Dan. Great to be here. You know, vote by mail is, or mail ballots, absentee ballots, whatever you want to call them, is a regular part of our elections. We know in 2016 that about 25% of Americans voted that way. You know, I think it's a fair guess to say that maybe double that. Again, it's going to depend. It's going to vary jurisdiction to jurisdiction, state to state, because of the different rules that are in place. But I think we're going to see nearly a doubling, again, a significant increase in mail ballots this year as people look to vote that way during the pandemic.
And of course, mail-in voting has been in the news. President Trump has criticized it repeatedly, and also gone after the post office. He said earlier this month that he did not want to provide or approve extra funding, additional funding for the post office that Democrats have requested, because he linked it directly to mail-in voting. And he said this was to Fox News on August 13th. He called that additional funding election money, basically. And he also said if Democrats don't get it, then you can't, quote, you can't have universal mail-in voting. What do you make of the president's remarks and his repeated attacks on mail-in voting?
I think it's really unfortunate. You know, when you talk to election officials, you know, Republicans, Democrats, across the country, people that this is their job and this is what they do, they have trust in the system. They know it works. They've been doing it for years. And the reality is the American voters are making this decision. You know, regardless of what a state's laws are, all states have a mail or absentee ballot system. And we see through the primaries, you know, as we go into the general, voters are making the decision about how they want to vote. And it's important for them to have a lot of options, and vote by mail or absentee ballot is one of those. We know that doesn't work for all Americans, so it's also important to have polling places that are as safe as possible. But again, the biggest part is having those options and recognizing that Americans are going to make the choice of how they vote this November.
And there's been public confusion about whether or not the Postal Service can handle this expected surge in mail-in votes. Is the USPS equipped for this?
Yeah, we talked to the USPS real early in the pandemic, you know, expressed some of those concerns. And again, they emphasized some of the things that you've certainly probably heard again recently, which is the volume that the post office handles on a regular basis far exceeds anything that would come in the ballot sense. And you can think about it at the holidays, you know, some of the examples that we heard from them were Christmas or Mother's Day, you know, where people, you know, you might send, you know, you're only sending one ballot, but you may send 40 or 50 Christmas cards. And so you can imagine sort of that volume isn't an issue. The biggest thing that comes into play with mail ballots or absentee ballots are deadlines. And so rather than a volume issue, it's just making sure that things are delivered on time. States really have two varieties. Some states require your ballot to be received by Election Day. Others require it to be postmarked by Election Day. And so really the thing that I've been saying to voters or anyone that has concern, you know, don't wait till that deadline. Get it in the mail early and just take care of it. Make sure it gets there in plenty of time. That's certainly what I'm going to do.
And Benjamin Hovland, we're also, you know, looking closely at the way different states are responding. Part of the confusion, of course, is that elections are run by states, so there are essentially 50 different systems in place around the country. You speak with state officials, election officials, every day. What are you hearing from them, and are any raising red flags about their ability to carry off this election in a timely fashion and meet their deadlines?
You know, you're right. I do have the privilege of speaking with election officials every day. And I'll tell you, it gives me great confidence in the system. You know, this is the job of being an election official is hard every year. And this year they are facing unprecedented challenges. You know, we're lucky to have these dedicated public servants, and we're lucky that they're contingency planners by nature. Usually what they're planning for tend to be more regionalized issues, you know, severe weather, fires, etc. And so this year what we're seeing is on a national scale. But really, since the start of this pandemic, you've seen election officials answer the call, look to adjust their systems. We were talking about mail ballots earlier. Again, making those decisions back in late March, early April, to try to figure out how they were going to be able to respond to what the voters wanted from them. And again, I've been, you know, very heartened to see that work firsthand and hear from election officials about all they're doing to make November as smooth as possible.
And I do want to return to President Trump for a moment and press you a little bit more on some of his remarks around this. You know, he has sort of tied the idea of an increase in mail-in voting to a rigged election, as he called it. We heard some of that rhetoric just this week at his first appearance at the RNC, where he said the Democrats were, quote, trying to steal, or they were stealing millions of votes, as he put it, and that it would be a rigged election if there are more mail-in votes. But studies have shown that voter fraud in this country is exceedingly rare. And I should note also that in states that do rely or focus on mail-in voting, there is no evidence of widespread voter fraud. Why would the president be putting out this message? And is it helpful to having Americans and voters understand the process?
Yeah, you know, I'm not going to speculate as to the reasons for some of those statements. I think I'll leave that up to others. But what I can tell you is, you know, that it absolutely doesn't help. And that time and time again, this issue has been looked at. As you mentioned, there's been study after study. There was a presidential commission created. There have been countless lawsuits on this issue. And when the rubber hits the road, there has been no real evidence. You know, there are small instances of fraud, usually in local elections like school board or sheriff, because a few votes can make a difference. But any kind of grand conspiracy, you know, that just isn't something that we've seen in elections and nothing that I would expect. I think for Americans that have concerns about that, again, they can get engaged, and that makes a huge difference. You know, again, checking, you know, we were talking about election officials and the job that they're looking at right now. Americans can do a lot to help that and give them self-confidence in the process. Checking their voter registration, making sure the information is current, like their current address. They can go to vote.gov and get to their state election official website there. 40 states have online registration. So that's a great step. Again, you want to make sure your address is current. That's a big deal. If you want to vote by mail, you need to have the right address. If you want to vote in person, having your address information updated means that you won't necessarily be in a situation where you get a provisional ballot that's less likely to be counted, or a change of address form that'll mean that you have to spend more time in the polling place. That's harder on poll workers. So taking care of that step on the front end is a big deal. And then, again, to have polling places, we need poll workers. And so if people really want to be a part of the process and see what the front lines of elections look like, you know, election officials still need poll workers. At the EAC, we launched a campaign called National Poll Worker Recruitment Day, which is actually next Tuesday, September 1st. You can get more information on that website, helpamericavote.gov. Would love for more people to see this and sign up to be a poll worker.
That is all important information for people interested in voting who might be confused about the process. Thank you for sharing that with our viewers, Ben Hovland. And I want to end with a question about the election night itself. There's already been talk that we may not have the results on that night, or maybe for days or even weeks after, because of this additional expected spike in mail-in voting and the time it might take to count those ballots. What is your view on the likelihood that the results will be there that night, the next day, versus potentially a significantly longer period of time?
Yeah, thanks for asking that. You know, I know that most Americans have grown accustomed to, you know, tuning in late Tuesday and hearing the election be called. That may not be the case this year, but in any year, election night results are always unofficial. And part of that is because, you know, they are trying to be provided for transparency and information for voters, but that is not the official final tally and the canvas process. And that's really where election officials sort of dot I's, cross T's, double check the map. You know, it, late on an election night, you may transpose a number, you know, if somebody's keying something in. And so election officials have this process in place where they do those official checks. And as you mentioned, with mail ballots this year being having a significant increase of mail ballots, depending on state statutes for counting those, when you're able to start processing those, et cetera, and what the deadlines in place are, you know, it may be a few days before that final tally is available, but that is expected. That is part of the process, and that is making sure that Americans' votes are cast and the will of the electorate is reflected in the outcome.
And just very quickly, in 30 seconds, Ben Hovland, given all these challenges we've been talking about, how confident are you in the results whenever they do come in?
I'm very confident. You know, I think the biggest thing right now for people, you know, I said quickly, is making that plan to vote, making sure your registration is current, and figuring out how you want to vote in your state. If that's mail, if that's early in person, you know, I've heard a lot of people talking about Election Day, November 3rd being the last day to vote. And I think the more people think of it that way, the more they'll be able to make sure they're able to participate, that their voice is heard, and ultimately the will of the American people will be reflected.
Ben Hovland, the chair of the U.S. Election Assistance Commission, thank you so much for joining us.
Thanks for having me, Dan.